For the next lab, you'll want to take a look at Moodle and download the two files that are suggested in the lab manual. And so you'll want to get to chapter 14 of the XC32 user guide. And in chapter 14 of the user guide, there is a description of an assembler file as well as a C file. And you'll want to use these inside of chapter 14 as a template for writing your code in the lab itself. I'm going to go over some of that code right now. So, first thing to notice is that there are two files. There is going to be a file with a .c extension. That's the standard C file. And in it, there's going to be a call to the xc.h header file. So we're going to include xc.h. And don't worry about plib like that. As well, don't worry about the system configuration right here. You don't need to know about that. In your own version of this code, you will want to put all those pragma statements that we normally put in here to configure your DP32 or WF32 boards. The thing to notice from here is that there is a declaration or definition of an ASM assembler file function. Okay, as well there is a global variable, and that global variable, ASM variable, is actually defined in the assembler file, but here we're making it available to the code in C by setting up as this extern unsigned int ASM variable. After that, we have another global variable. Actually, we have two more. And these right here are global variables that are defined inside of the C function. After that, we have our main function. And inside of the main function, there is the standard tri-state port A and latch port A. The thing that's interesting to note here is the use of UL at the end of the value and the hex number right here. And that stands for unsigned long. And you don't have to put it in there, but it's handy and it makes sure that things are well defined. When you call the function ASM function, so this is calling an assembler function, you're passing it a parameter or a variable, and that variable, or that in this case actually it's a constant, has a U at the end of it, and that means that the number itself is defined as unsigned. Okay. All right. So from there, there's also a global variable that's incremented, and that global variable is being used in the assembler function. And then we have another function right here that is used from the assembler function. So our assembler function can call C functions. What we're truly interested in right now, though, is a C function that can call that assembler function right there. So now we're going to take a look at the assembler file itself. The assembler file, ex1.s, has a capital S file extension. Super important that you have that capital S. Lowercase s will not work very well. So capital S. We can see once again that we are declaring that we need to have this xc.h include file. This .text tells the compiler where in memory to put the assembler file. And here, this is a safety thing. We want to make sure that we don't optimize out any of the code that's declared in this assembler file. After that, we state that there is a function. And there's a label for that function with a colon right beside it. And this effectively tells the compiler that in memory somewhere, we are going to define a function called ASM function. You'll want to mimic exactly that right there. You also need to have the ASM function label. So this right here is a label. And then you need to do a stack modification. And for the most part, what you're going to be dealing with is a change in stack pointer. Of -4. So you're going to want to shift the location of the stack pointer by 4 effectively memory locations in one particular direction, and then you're going to store whatever the value of S0 was on the stack itself. So we are storing S0 on the stack. And sometimes we store more than just S0. We might store other registers as well, but in this case it's just going to be S0, and for the most part for your lab you just have to worry about S0. So that's what you do right there. And that setting up or prologue of the assembly file is almost always done. From here, what we do is we are going to have two stages, 1 and 2. And these are effectively the main component of your assembler function. The first one asks that the address of the latch a clear command be sent into S0. And then from there, what we're going to do is we're going to take the value of A0 and put it into the address pointed to by S0, which means effectively we're going to take A0, which was the input argument, and we're going to put that into latch clears address. We're effectively going to say that the latch A clear register should contain the value for A0. From there, what's going on is we are going to take the address of port A, store it in S0, then we're going to load whatever was in port A, and we're going to send it into S1. Take whatever the value in port A was and send it to register S1. After that, what we want to do is load the address of the global variable C variable, and we want to make a copy of S1 into the address pointed to by C variable. So we're going to take a copy of S1 and put it into the C variable, which happens to be the value that was read at port A as well. So this is how you end up shifting values around from one register to another, from one memory location to another. And in our case, this is particularly important for taking input arguments from a function and doing something with it within your function itself. So in this case, we're using the input argument to the assembler function, and we're sending it into the latch a clear value register. So it will clear bits that are inside of latch A. After that, we have something called a function epilogue. And this epilogue effectively restores S0, which had been stored earlier. And there's a typo in the text. This should read 4. So SP, so it's add immediate unsigned stack pointer, comma, stack pointer, comma, 4. After that, something you don't need to worry about too much. This is the assembler file calling a C function. in this case, the C function that we're calling is called foo. Okay, so we're going to jump to foo. What's more important for your lab, so don't worry about this so much. Okay, none of that. This, which is return to caller, has a jump to a location described by the return address register, which is RA. And what this is going to do is it tells the assembler function to go back to the memory location of the C file function that called the assembler function. So we're going to go back to where we came from. And then from there, the last thing that's important here is this is the end of the assembler function. And this is effectively the equivalent of that curly brace in C. Finally, at the bottom of that sample assembler file, there is the declaration or the definition of a global variable in assembler. And again, there's the definition of where it's located in the .bss section. It's defined as a global, and there's this business of aligning and spacing that tells you basically how big the variable is supposed to be and how we're supposed to count addresses around it. So the last thing that we need to do is to show you how to load up or initialize two files inside of a new project in MPLABX. So I'm going to call up MPLABX like this. I'm going to set up a new project. I go microchip embedded, standalone project. I'm going to declare it for a 32-bit, and I'm going to choose the 250/128B. Like that. I'll choose a PIC kit 3. You choose the other one that you're normally used to, the PGM from ChipKit. And I'm going to say this is a mixed CASM project. So you can see on the left-hand side I've got my project right there. I go to source, I right-click on source files, I say new, I'm going to go to other, here, other right there, and I want to just have an empty file. I'm going to call this my ASM file dot capital S. This is one of the only settings that allows you to put in an arbitrary file extension. So I'm going to do dot capital S. I'm going to double click on it, and then you can see that if I were to write things like .bss or .text or something like that, or if I were to write something along those lines, you can see that this is standard assembler code. This isn't what you should actually write, but this would be an example of something that you could write. I go back over to source files, I right-click on it, I say new, C main file. I call this my C file, like that. And as you can see, where did that go? There we are. This is the standard C file right here, and you fill this in with whatever regular C code that you would want, including all the pragma statements and things like that. And there you have it. That's a basic introduction of how to mix assembler and C files together. We will talk about this more on Monday during the flipped classroom activity that we will be doing. Make sure that you bring all of the documentation that's described on the Moodle site.